which is one set of time fields, into another. So the Merkaba vehicle, as they call it, angular rotation that the particles move on. In a three-dimensional system, it's actually the different angles of rotation that create a hologram that allow light to bend, like sound waves to bend in a way that we can get that three-dimensional illusion off of something that's really not three-dimensional. So angular rotation of particle spin has a lot to do with things later, too, as we learn more of the things of integrating the Hoover bodies, because we will be changing, by changing the vibration and oscillatory rates, we will be changing the angular rotation of particle spin to make the Merkaba vehicle happen more quickly. Now, I don't know if any of you have heard of Merkaba, but Merkaba is basically an energy construct that you can form within a field. It's two counter-rotating spirals of electromagnetic energy that, when it is activated, creates a vessel of frequency that you can move your biology from one set of frequency bands into another, which is one set of time fields into another. So the Merkaba vehicle, as they call it, is the activation of higher-dimensional identity, which creates different wave spectrum in the biofield, which allows the biofield to get out of phase lock in this dimension, in this time zone.
How do you steer your Merkaba? Ever think about it? Okay, I have this Merkaba field. Okay, I'm going to make a really big one. Great, what do I do with it then? Right? Like, how do I point it in the right direction? What do you do? Point your head? I mean, yeah. No. We're going to do what's called full Rishik shield activation, which is the full level 3, the flame body activation, Rishaic level. And we'll find in there that what controls the where you point your Merkaba is a built-in steering wheel that's called the rod. Of rod and staff fame. The rod has to do with your palms and with something that activates in the palms under what's called the 1111 or the 211 code. And we're going to learn how to open that code in the body. We had it spontaneously happen the other night where the palms went. And now we've had palms activate for cathara healing and that kind of stuff. And you could feel little vortices, and you could feel when they're really pushing energy. This was a whole different feeling. I really woke up and said, oh, God, no, it's not going to be stigmata, is it? I hate that stuff. You know? And they said, no, when your template's working right, you don't get stigmata. You know? It's only when it's not working right that it damages the matter form in the flesh. But there was this amazing feeling in my palms. I could distinctly feel discs of energy. It felt like little thin, like wafer-shaped discs spinning, one way, one the other, and then there was a third one in between them that did something different. It vibrated instead of spun, and they all came together, and I found myself, it kind of blew me into the astral, and I'm in the astral, and these huge flames about this high were all of a sudden in the palms. I was going, ow, it's hot. They were really, really hot. You know, and Ma'a was working with me, Iyani Ma'a. And he's saying, oh, don't worry about it, you're all right. Yeah. Okay. This is key to understanding later the more advanced Merkaba mechanics and the Ark of the Covenant gates. The inner Eka system is the system that our system manifested out of. This system around it, the four crosses there, the four arms of the cross, is called the Veka system, as it came out of the inner Eka system. And the inner Eka is part of something even bigger that's called the Akasha. The Veka systems here are called quadrants. Each one of these little cathara grids in the Veka is called a quadrant. We're in Veka quadrant 4, density 1. So we're actually down here. This is where our universe exists. When we look up at the stars in the sky and look out at space, we're actually seeing just this much of all that. But that's not all. Remember, we're seeing that plus that Akasha shape is connected to the next shape up. And these are the Eka maps of the God world gates again. Okay. Akasha connects to the Akasha A. These are called spectra within the Akasha A. This is an Akasha A spectra. These get bigger and connect to more that are the Akasha Eya, our core God world, the first level of creation, the first level of expression of source. So this Akasha Eya spectra connects into this. Now, as we notice, we get the same pattern, but it's repeating. And if you look at the top, it actually started from the top and spiraled down. Now, I say spiraled because Merkaba fields actually connect all of this together. And Merkaba fields are key to reconnecting it if you've become disconnected from it. Becoming disconnected from this pattern of grid work that exists as the core template of cosmic order means you become a finite being, means you lose the ability to run the eternally available perpetual life, primal life force currents from source. And that's what has happened here in this universal Vekka. We have 2/3 of the template reversed and 1/3 left. And during the period that we're entering now, we are going to have our template restored. If it wasn't restored, the whole thing would fall into black hole status, which is anti-Christo status, because it can no longer run Christo's frequency. And it has no other destiny other than to eventually expend its own energy, self-consume, and implode back into space dust, and be stuck in the time matrix arena, the manifestation arena. So all of these things are very important to learning what mastery, spiritual mastery, is really about. And there is no difference between spiritual mastery and manifest mastery. One implies the other. We are learning the secrets of creation. The two spirals link, right? That's where you'd have that V shape coming up, the tetrahedronal shape coming up. When this Merkaba, which is called a Bi-Vekka Merkaba, that's capable of going vertical or horizontal, but it cannot go diagonal, when this fully activates, this center of, you could call it almost the center of gravity, shifts up to here into the Azurae point, what's called the Azurae point. So you will see the Christic Merkaba mechanics that we're going to go forth with in this evening's program, how they are all centered from the Azurae point, which is at the thymus gland. So this locking in down here is how the Merkaba, a normal Bi-Vekka Merkaba, functions when it is not activated. When it is activated, that whole axis shifts up here and the angles change into a natural Bi-Vekka Merkaba configuration, which is the density, the like a 12-dimensional Merkaba. But for now, we're dealing with the basic shape of Merkaba as on the personal level. The personal level, for anybody that doesn't know, these are the shields. Your scalar template shields is a Maharic shield down here that everything is based on. It has to come through the base 12 frequencies of the D12 Maharada current. That's what your shields would look like if you took the Merkaba field away from them. Now, we learned that that apparatus called the Merkaba field, what its purpose is, has to do with the chakras in your feet, around the balls of your feet, and in the ones in your heels as well, where you may find hot foot happening sometimes. There will be a point in time once the body matter is de-densified to a sufficient level where it's not going to get fried by those frequencies. You couldn't activate a Christar vehicle right now. You'd vaporize your body, because the matter particles have to be gently and slowly and in the right sequence re-spiritualized and de-densified by the natural processes inherent to Rasha body activation, where the right sets of frequencies come in at the right times and those kind of things.
All right, talking to yourself. You're damn right. You need to talk to yourself, because if your heart is right and you are balanced and you are in harmony with universal law, you're talking to your higher self, and it will respond.
Process. You could end up talking to your inner consciousness. At first, you may feel uncomfortable talking to your inner consciousness, but this discomfort will slowly disappear and you will feel that your inner consciousness is, in fact, your long-lost friend. It will be an incredible experience when you can speak freely to your inner consciousness.
If the situation is right and exact and aligned with universal law. So let me tell y'all what happened, right? I was just sitting up there and I was talking to myself, not verbally, like physical wise, but mentally. I was talking to myself and I said, never forget this. I was thinking to myself, I said, I wonder what it would feel like to activate my Merkaba, my light body. This is no bullshit. I don't give a shit. If nobody believes me, I don't give a shit. As long as I know, that's all that matters. This was a personal initiation. It had nothing to do with nobody, but I'm still gonna share it with you. So, I could hear this noise, this humming noise. And it began to get louder and louder. And it started, let me tell you what it sounded like. It sounded like this. I'm trying to mimic it. It was like pulsating, like orbiting or something. I didn't get scared. I called on it, so I was looking for something to happen. When I call on something, I'm looking for results. So, and it was just the wonder. The part I wondered, like, what it would feel like to activate my Merkaba. And every time I have ever said that, I've had some type of supernatural experience take place. So I could feel this energy. I could feel currents of electric, like electromagnetic waves, going submerging over my physical body. and because for some reason I was aggravated. I was not at ease. And because I was not at ease, these electrical voltages, they hurt. They hurt it. I ain't gonna lie, she hurt it like hell. It felt like I was being tased. Oh, on one side of my body, and as it submerged on the other side, it felt like I was being tased. Like being electrocuted. But as I relaxed and I submitted to the current, it went away. But I still can hear it orbiting. So what I did the first time, that same night, the first time that the energy was too strong and it was, shit, felt like I was being electrocuted, I broke the connection. I just, basically with my will, I broke the connection. I started moving and trying to like get this shit off me type of ordeal. But I said, damn. I remember thinking to myself, damn, I just activated my Merkaba. I got to do this again. So I summoned my Merkaba again. All I did was, let me tell y'all something. If you want to summon the Merkaba, if you ever activate it and you lose it, if you want to summon it again, channel the same feeling that you had the first time when you called it upon and it came. I ain't do no meditations, none of this shit, not degrading none of these meditations, but I didn't do none of these meditations that is in the book, The Flower of Life, Volume 1 and 2. I didn't do no meditations at all. All I did was called upon myself, my higher self.
But it will eventually get to the point when you hit that zero-G state, you can levitate, first of all. You can go into full orb, which means completely turn into light, not just lighter matter, right? It's an amazing new world. It is a new world. It is a world like nothing that we've had here for a very, very long time, but we've seen little glimpses in sci-fi and that kind of stuff on TV and in movies and, you know, books and that kind of stuff. Those things are just little bits of race memory left behind. About once upon a time, somebody could do this, or maybe we just wished we could. Angelic humans should be able to orb. A 12-strand pattern should be able to orb. Most things, which means go into some degree of starfire.
It is time, dear ones, to activate your Merkaba. The six-pointed star tetrahedron that surrounds your body of light. This vehicle is activated by connecting your vibration, energy, and matter with your willpower, wisdom, and love. When you become conscious and aware of this light vehicle, you can no longer be controlled by the matrix. You awaken to your true power as co-creator with the divine source of intelligence. You tap into your infinite potential and vibrate with source with the mantra of I am. When you reach this awareness, it requires you to accept responsibility for how your reality is showing up. You are living in a holographic reality and you will now receive DNA upgrades from source. There is no looking back.
The Merkaba, which is a spaceship you build by yourself for yourself. When a person initially activates their Merkaba, they don't realize that they're now different. You're still observing and interacting in the 3D world, but your vibration has been elevated to a 5D level. You see the world from an elevated state. We are becoming our higher self.
Our Merkaba is another energy with inside the physical body that's lying dormant within. Just like the chakra system, though you do have one dominant chakra that is activated, the rest of them pretty much are lying dormant, along with the Kundalini energy.
When you say raising now the Merkaba, and all those who seek to do it, they're now seeking to get the vehicle of light once more as they did before. And it was said that the woman came in the vehicle of light. Nothing like what we're talking about now, a spaceship, but the souls that came in then were so advanced, they created their own ship, the ship of light, which has nothing to do with metal and metallurgy and thrust and carbon dioxide and fossil fuel. It was a vehicle of light, which we still use if you have melanin each night when you come out of your body and travel in what they call astral projection. And the best they can do is remote viewing, and they take away the biggest privilege you've ever had. You misuse it by taking their drugs, and then you wonder what has happened to you and what's wrong. Reawaken. The light is still inside. It's just the vehicle you no longer know how to master. So they're now trying to do what you're supposed to do, and the very pyramids that they're using were the ones where you could instruct a person, find out if the person was an initiate, because when they sat in that king's chamber, which was never used as a tomb, it was used as a sepulcher to separate the light body by showing you that you were fasted enough, was strong enough to separate that body and go on your journey of the soul. So then they had to watch over your body when you were gone, because in time out in space, in a time in that vehicle, it was not the same as Earth time. So to keep it calibrated, they used to project into pyramids to pyramids, and that's why you will find on all planets under the belief of Atan, on the One, have pyramids on them, because that was the vehicle and the means of transportation by which the light body could be aroused if you were not able to do it yourself.
It was believed that the spinning of the tetrahedrons would create a powerful three-dimensional energy field that would lift the soul out of the physical body and into higher realms of consciousness. The Merkaba was often used in funerary rituals to help guide the soul on its journey to the afterlife. The Merkaba was also believed to be a powerful protection symbol and was often placed in tomb walls and coffins to protect the soul on its journey to the afterlife. It was used in many temple ceremonies because it was believed to be a tool for connecting to the gods and accessing higher level of consciousness. Many priests would often meditate on the symbol, using it as a tool for assessing spiritual knowledge and wisdom, the same way Thoth described it in the Emerald Tablets. Today, the Merkaba is still being used in various spiritual practices, from meditation to energy healing, and can be found in ancient temples and modern-day spiritual communities alike. But the true power of the symbol remains elusive. One way that you can use the Merkaba in your meditation is by finding a quiet and comfortable place to sit or lay down. Close your eyes and take a few deep breaths to relax your body and clear your mind. Next, imagine a Merkaba in your mind's eye. You can visualize two overlapping tetrahedrons, one pointing upward and the other one pointing downward. See the image as vividly as possible and imagine yourself at the center of the shape. Focus your attention on the Merkaba and try to feel the energy and vibration of the symbol. Try to imagine the Merkaba spinning. This is said to activate the energy field of the symbol. As you meditate, you can repeat a mantra or affirmation that resonates with you and the purpose of your meditation. For example, you can repeat the phrase, "I am one with the universe," or "I am connected to the divine." Continue to focus your attention on the Merkaba and your mantra for as long as you feel comfortable. When you're ready, take a deep breath and slowly open your eyes. When you meditate on the Merkaba image, it is said to bring about a number of benefits, both physically and spiritually. It increases your spiritual awareness and connection to the divine. It improves focus and concentration. It improves your emotional well-being and reduces stress and anxiety. You get a greater sense of inner peace and balance. It increases energy and vitality. And it improves your overall well-being. As we come to the end of our exploration of the Merkaba, one thing becomes clear. There's still so much more to uncover. This powerful symbol holds within it the key to unlocking our true spiritual potential.
They knew that Atlantis would sink, and they would be ready.
Previously on Thoth and Pals.
Thoth, the poles are shifting.
Oh, the poles shift?
Yeah, whoa, what's wrong with your eyes?
I don't know.
When Thoth first saw signs of the polar shift, they returned to the land of Chem and raised the warship into the sky. They went to Atlantis and picked up the Nakals. The Nakals weren't just passengers, though, and each and every being was working in unity to create a very powerful Merkaba around themselves and the ship. They returned to the Great Pyramid and landed the ship on top, forming the Phi ratio with the pyramid. And then, it happened. The poles began to shift, and human consciousness began to plummet. Simultaneously, the electromagnetic and magnetic fields of the Earth collapsed, and all life on the planet went into the Great Void, the 3.5 days of absolute blackness described by many ancient cultures in the world. The Emerald Tablets say that whenever we go through a polar shift, we go through a void space as we change our frequencies for about 3.5 days. This is also in the Troano document, depicted by 3.5 stones painted black. This refers to a time when we go through what science calls the electromagnetic null zone. During the pole shift, a phenomenon takes place where everything just seems to disappear for a certain time. Usually it's between 2 to 4 days, and the last time it was 3.5 days. Here's where it gets interesting. What happens to us does not usually happen to a normal species, because most advanced species will have their Merkabas handy at the time of the shift. We didn't, due to our little crisis, and we got sucked into the void space without protection. This resulted in us losing our memories. Science realizes that all of our memories are connected through cells in our brains as well as fields around our heads. What is not entirely understood by science yet, at least not directly, is the connection our memories have with the planet itself. We've discussed this before. The magnetics of the Earth affect how we think and act. The Merkaba is an electromagnetic field that you create around your body that can serve as protection from void as you're consciously going through it. What happened to us when we didn't have that protection? It was a clean wipe. When we existed on Atlantis, we were living at a very high level of consciousness in a higher dimension. We had extremely advanced and sophisticated bodies and minds, and were capable of practically anything, living in a dimension where molecules were spaced so far apart that consciousness could interact with them without physically moving. It's hard to explain because you can literally shape your environment immediately through your consciousness in these higher frequencies. In that sense, we were creators, knowing and understanding oneness, beings of love. But then we fell. We dropped back down to this place called the third dimension. We also fell in consciousness back to zero. We forgot how to use the pineal gland, and it slowly shrunk to the size it is now, like a raisin, where it's supposed to be eyeball size. When this happened, we forgot how to breathe source energy into our bodies, and our lifespans went kaput. Eventually, we went from 900 years to what it is today. We had not experienced this dense reality that we had before, at least for a very long time. We were kind of like a supercomputer that gets completely wiped, no operating system or anything. We had these advanced physical bodies, but we didn't know how to use them. This is why today we are so physically advanced compared to pretty much all the other animals in this third dimension.
We were a race of beings. We did not start on this planet. We did not come from apes. We came from a level of higher evolution, and we had a genetic code that had 12 strands of DNA activated within it. That 12-strand pattern is called the silicate matrix. And the silicate matrix still remains as a dormant potential within the humans of today. That's what these classes are about. We have the abilities within us, if we can understand what the process of DNA evolution and how that applies to our consciousness, we can understand this process. We can bring those potentials of 12 strands of DNA back into activation. Now, we have two identified strands, as far as our scientific community knows. And we attribute things, you know, the genetic characteristics, eye color, hair color, disease sometimes, to genetic factors. There are levels of DNA structure that are even below that. There are base structures of DNA. And when we get into this, we're getting into something called chelantic morphogenetic science. It's the science of morphogenetic fields. Morphogenetic fields are the form-holding blueprints that create grids of electromagnetic energy upon which matter particles can compose themselves to form matter forms. So when we're dealing with our DNA, we are dealing with a level that's even below that, that is the morphogenetic field. In the course that we're going to do today, there was some very interesting new information given to me, and that's why I'm excited to present it to the people who've had the material from before, and I'm trying to figure out how to present it to the people who haven't, because it's the next level up. Very quickly speaking, in the silicate matrix, which we are trying to activate in our DNA through these classes, there are 12 strands of DNA. They are double heli. You have one magnetic heli and one electrical heli. So you have 12 of those. That's the basic structure. Most of them are dormant right now. Most of us on the planet right now have with an accretion level, which is a DNA activation level, of between 3 and 3.5. Our scientists see one double helix. That is because there are particles that vibrate at a different angle of rotation and vibrate at a slower pulse than our particles in our perceptual field and the perceptual field of our instruments, and there are ones that vibrate higher. DNA is stacked in an overlay form, and you will only be able to perceive from any one system the portions of the particles that vibrate within that system. So right now, we don't have the instrumentation here. Well, actually, we do. The physical body has the ability to see those multidimensional scales, but they're not able to see them with scientific instrumentation. But we are dealing with an overlay structure of 12 DNA strands, most of which are dormant.